Well, good afternoon, everyone. I'm Rona Free. I'm the provost at Eastern, and I'm very happy to welcome you to the second last lecture at Eastern. This is a series that we just started this year. Obviously, we borrowed the idea from elsewhere, but I think it's a good idea to borrow good ideas. And so this is a series that gives us a chance to hear from our retiring faculty before they leave. This year, we had two faculty who decided to retire at the end of this academic year. Fortunately, they both agreed to give last lectures. And actually, the two of them are a perfect combination representing Eastern. The first last lecture was by Bill Newell, who's a philosopher. And so it was very appropriate that at a liberal arts institution, the first last lecture is from a philosopher. But then, as you all know, Eastern's roots are as a teaching institution. And so it's equally fitting that our second last lecture be someone who's spent their career working with students who are going to go out and become teachers. So our second last lecture will be by Neil Williams, and Neil will be introduced by his longtime colleague, Dan Switchenko. So Dan, please.
I was told that I had to speak into this thing for the camera. This is truly an honor. Neil arrived at Eastern in January of 1983. He was instrumental in the development of what has proven to be one of the most outstanding physical education, teacher education programs in the Northeast. During his tenure here at Eastern, Neil has published over 50 articles. He has been the featured speaker at countless physical education and professional education conferences, not only here at Eastern and throughout the United States, but in England, in Spain, in Hong Kong, and in China. In the classroom, Neil has always made his content relevant. He has taught writing to our majors better than any other physical educator in America, and I say that in all sincerity. And he's been tireless in his demand of excellence on the part of each and every one of our students. There are very few faculty that have the ability to teach the variety of courses that Neil has taught here at Eastern. Introduction to physical education, every imaginable pedagogy class, and of course his favorite, adventure running. Neil was nominated to the American Academy of Higher Education as an exemplary teacher in 1992, and then again in 1993. He was Eastern's most outstanding teacher in 1996, and then won the Distinguished Professor Award in the year 2000. Neil gained national prominence in 2001 for his views on physical education curriculum. He was invited to numerous national radio and television shows, including HBO Real Sports, The Today Show, and The Daily Show with Jon Stewart. Neil has contributed in so many different ways. He's most recognized for his three-part series of articles titled The Physical Education Hall of Shame. These articles were published in the Journal of Health, Physical Education, Recreation, and Dance, and to this day, they remain the most reprinted articles in the journal's history. Neil has always prided himself in his ability to be competitive in a variety of sports, and he's also worked hard throughout his career at maintaining a very high level of physical fitness. A number of years back, as he approached the age of 60, we were in the locker room following a workout, and he expressed a concern to me. He had said, you know, when I first started teaching adventure running, I was at the head of the pack. I led the students. And I'm kind of concerned because now I'm in the middle of the pack. And I explained to him that, you know, one's maximum oxygen consumption begins to decrease at a rate of about 1% per year, beginning as early as the age of 25. And then as one approaches the age of 60, that rate of decline doubles. That's what was happening. And, you know, when you consider, Neil, your interest in sport, your interest in fitness, and the fact that in a couple of weeks you're going to retire, I think it's important for you to recognize the signs of knowing when you're really getting old. So I've looked into that. And you can see that, Charlie, you would agree, this is the most widely read exercise science journal, not only in America, but probably the world. These are the signs of knowing that you're, in fact, getting old, Neil. Number 10, when EMTs pay particular attention to the events that you're in, you know you're getting old. Number 9, when your knees make noises that your opponents can hear, you know you're getting old. Number 8, you're a right-handed racquetball player, but your left elbow hurts, you know you're getting old. Number 7, packing your athletic bag takes longer than competing in your event, you know you're getting old. Number 6, your opponents are overcome by Bengay fumes, you know you're getting old. Number 5, you remember the 1964 Olympics, you know you're getting old. Number 4, you try to plant your foot to change directions, but you continue for 3 more strides, you know you're getting old. Number 3, you get warmed up and tired at the same time. Number 2, you bend over to tie your shoes and you remain in that position for 24 hours, you know you're getting old. And last but not least, completing an event is every bit as rewarding as winning that event. Those are the best signs of knowing that you truly are getting up. But all kidding aside, you've been a consummate professional, both in the classroom and as a department chair. You've been a valued colleague, and most of all, you've been a great friend for 31 and a half years. I thank you, our students thank you, the department thanks you, and the university thanks you for making Eastern the place that it is.
Thanks.
And now, presenting his last lecture. Oh, by the way, I had a few of your students, they bumped into me and they said, well, since this is Dr. Williams's last lecture, does that mean we have to go to class for the remainder of the semester? And I referred them to Rona, so you have nothing to worry about.
Thank
okay?
you.
Presenting his last lecture, titled, I Thought I Was Gonna Be a Lawyer, Dr. Neil Williams.
I think I'm plugged in here. Here we go. First of all, thank you all for coming today. I'm really so pleased to see so many of my friends here and students, colleagues. So thanks, and we'll see what happens. Most of this talk is just about the importance of cultural literacy and the relevance of those things as we teach our classes and as we live our lives. So come into my parlor, said the spider to the fly, and here we are. I want to thank everybody who helped me get here today. That's a lot of people, former students. There are lots of them out there. I really appreciate that. My own teachers, my friends here at the university, my colleagues in teaching. There are several of them here. I'm so happy to see them. My colleagues who do the hard work on campus, who shovel the snow, who police the streets, who take care of all the business of the university so that we don't have to worry about those things. The electricians, the plumbers, all those folks. My mentors, people who supervise me, people I supervise, and I'm just happy to be here to do this today. So thank you all so much, appreciate that. Rona asked me to do this show. I'm just looking at guys and dolls. Rona asked me to do this, and at first I turned her down. I said I didn't really want to do it. I was a little bit afraid to do it. And I just went home and Sherry talked to me, and I didn't even introduce my wife and my son, which I should do, because they're part of the people who helped me get here. So my wife is here. Sherry, would you just stand up, please? And my son, Adam, is here. He flew in from Colorado for this. The reason I didn't mention them is because I can't see the bottom of my notes here on this screen. But anyway, so Rona asked me to do this, and I didn't want to do it. I said, nah, and I went away. And some people said you should. So part of my discussion was in college, I was a freshman. I was 17 years old, away for the first time, and I took a music theory class my very first semester because I loved music so much. And we were singing Bach chorales in there, and it was a lot of fun, and I was just singing along, and somebody in the class came up to me about 5 weeks or 6 weeks into the semester and said, you know what, we want you to be one of the leads in Guys and Dolls. And I said, why? And they said, because you can sing. And I said, well, I don't want to do that. So I didn't. And I turned it down. And I saw the show when they put it on. You must know the show. When you see a Joe spending all kinds of dough, and he smells from Vitalis and Barbasol, call it sad, call it funny, but it's better than even money that the guy's only doing it for some doll. And I was just like so sad I didn't do the show. And I just sort of said to myself, don't let opportunities get away from you again. And so I tried to not do that. And that's sort of what resonated with me. I've always regretted things I didn't do a whole lot more than the things that I actually did, because I never did anything bad. I was such a good kid. So I was a little bit afraid at the start. Now I'm a lot afraid, but here we go. This is Wolf Rock in Mansfield, Connecticut. I was introduced to Wolf Rock by Clyde Washburn, Cindy Washburn's husband. And Clyde was teaching here in the department when I first showed up, and they gave me a course, Adventure Running. It was sort of a filler for me. And I was going to do it for one semester. This place, if you have never been there, I've been there 100 times, and at least. It overlooks the campus. You can see the entire campus over the tops of the trees. And I've run up the hill 60 times. And over the years, I have calculated that I did 840 adventure running meetings over 30 years, 3,000 miles, and we never canceled one. And at the beginning, as Dan said, I could run with them, and later on, I could run in the middle of them. And last spring, I was running behind them all. And I thought, this is not a good situation. So I stopped teaching it. But today's weather was what I hope for every day in adventure running. Snow in the morning, being able to get out in the woods, be the first ones out to make treks, and slip and slide all the way up. So that was adventure running. And today's a perfect day for this poem, which is by Robert Frost. The sun was warm, but the wind was chill. You know how it is on an April day. When the sun is out and the wind is still, you're 1 month on in the middle of May. But if you so much as dare to speak, a cloud comes over the sunlit arch, the wind blows off a frozen peak, and you're 2 months back in the middle of March. So here I am, a phys ed guy at a liberal arts college. I think it's a kind of a strange situation, but we are, as Rona said, part of the history of Eastern. And it was my favorite class. I learned to love nature, and I learned to love the woods, and it changed the way I lived my life just by doing that class with the students. It has to be a few cute photos of me, so here you go. You feel free to ooh and ah. This is me at 3 years old. We had a big deal in my house. A professional photographer came. I'm so cute. And this is our log cabin that we grew up in. My father was a veteran of World War II, and we lived in these barracks that were, I would think, maybe 15 feet wide and 20 feet long. And there I am at the base of the steps on a bicycle, because I was always on something with some sports equipment. And there's my sister with her baby carriage. And we were both being programmed early on. I became the young cowboy at age 5. And every year for Christmas, my grandmother would give me a set of guns. And every year, about by New Year's, I had lost them. So, but I was the cowboy, and my sister became the mother, and she still is the mother. She's 70 years old, taking care of everything. I have a younger sister who's not in these photos today. She's a PhD economist from Yale, so some things work out for some people. And but I was sort of this independent cowboy guy who liked sport activity, but I was different from all the other people who like sport activity. I really like sport in a different way. This is me as I won the National Wally Cox Look-Alike Contest. Do you remember Wally Cox? Yeah, Mr. Peepers. I had the same glass. I don't know what my parents were thinking, honest to goodness. But I still had the cowboy shirt. I swear, I thought that guy was my father. This is one of my favorite pictures ever of me. This was taken by my friend Mickey Kale. Mickey saw me on HBO Real Sports and called me up, and he said, you know what, I have a picture of you, Neil, from 1959 when we were out, and the story of this picture is it was taken with that particular type of camera, which is hard to take a picture of anything, even if people are standing still. And we had one shot left, and I told Mickey, stand over there, I'm gonna hit the camera with the snowball. And I did. And the snowball is right in the middle of it, and I hit the camera, and he got this picture. And I didn't see this picture ever. It showed up 10 years ago or 8 years ago after I'd been on TV. So it was really nice, but the form is absolutely impeccable. It's unbelievable. This is my high school graduation. My mother, the first generation of Hungarian immigrants. My father, the first generation of Russian immigrants. They never got an education, both really bright people. And they wanted us to go to school. So it wasn't a question of, well, was I going to get the chance to go to school? It was, you are going to college and just plan your life around that. It's going to happen. My father loved music and politics. My mother loved politics and music, so our dinner discussions were peppered with people singing songs and people arguing politics, and as a result of that, I love music and I hate politics. So I try to avoid discussing that whenever I can. My college years, I think, were the four most amazing years that anybody's ever lived through. I just happened to be in college at that time. John Kennedy was assassinated in my freshman year in November. His hope and his energy just fabulous for us as young students, and he was assassinated. Martin Luther King, the champion of perhaps the greatest cause our country has ever had, and he was assassinated a year after I graduated from college. Gloria Steinem, the champion of women's rights, her elegance, her calm demeanor, her beautiful speech. She's still speaking today. She was just at North Adams, I think, a month or two ago, and she's about 78 years old now. Whoa. And the Vietnam War, which was the first time America ever said, hell no, we won't go. And we wouldn't. But those are my 4 years at college. This is me in the middle of college in my very cute stage. And that stage lasted about a month and a half. And during that time, I met Sherry. So the timing was really good. This is the young couple. I think this is spring weekend of my senior year, and we don't have that many photos, but God, she was beautiful. She still is. And we have been together for 49 years as friends and spouses. One thing you didn't know about me, I am the foremost expert in America on Planters Peanuts memorabilia predating 1960, which is the Standard Brands era. And this scale appeared in every Mr. Peanut store around the country. There's one in Atlantic City. Bob, you probably saw it. That scale's worth about $25,000. But I wrote the price guide for these things back in the 90s. Did you know that? Charlie Wynn knew that. He gave me a Mr. Peanut pencil once. I still have it. Another thing you don't know about me is that I love antiques, and I collect. I had the world's largest collection of these things. These are lampshades. And they are from Sandwich, Mass, made between 1874 and 1876, and they go on certain kind of lamp, and my collection was displayed at the Sandwich Glass Museum for a year. So we have prowled the countryside looking for antiques. So now my talk. I really love my job, always have. It's been fun to come to work, especially the last 10 years or so. Our department has been harmonious. We have agreed on so much, even though we've struggled with key issues. We get along, we respect each other. It's fun coming to work, and I'm in a great community with wonderful people here at Eastern. Some people I've just met, like Caitlin I've just met, and Suki I've just met, and others in here I've probably just met. And it's so nice for me at a point in my career to meet fascinating, smart people who have come to the college to make it better than I ever had the chance to do. So it's fantastic, and I just had the freedom to run around in this. Being a college professor is fabulous. It's just fabulous. Just go out the door whenever you want and come back whenever you want, but you better do something in the interim. I didn't always want to be a PE teacher, though. I was supposed to be a lawyer. My mother wanted me to be a lawyer. Nobody in my family was a professional of any kind. My mother sold china in Bloomingdale's. My father sold shoes for a company called Regal Shoes, and he sold meat. And my older sister went to college first, but she was interested in her MRS, more than anything else. So she got married right away, and these heroes weren't around then. But I hope you remember Mr. Cutlip from the Wonder Years. He's my favorite phys ed teacher. He's just wonderful. This is Billy Bob Thornton, who is, this is what I do in my classes now to keep the peace. Before Eastern, I had taught physical education in public schools for about 10 years. And my students learned by doing. So these are not pictures of what I was doing. These are pictures I found of kids in activity. And you can actually see their engagement. And this is where I'm going in my lecture today. I learned to know when my teaching methods weren't working. I learned to know when they were. And I could see it just in the way the students reacted to it. And if I had a strength in teaching, if I have a strength in teaching at all, it is the ability to recognize when my audience is not with me. And I'm not so sure right now. But I felt that was my talent, because as soon as I saw something wasn't working, I changed what I was doing. So I arrived here in 1983. I'd never ever taught in a classroom. It's hard to believe, but I never had. I'd been in gymnasiums my whole career, and I was more than a little bit nervous about it. We had the best of technology then, and not everybody remembers this, but this is an electric typewriter, a mimeo machine, a chalkboard. Over here is a slide projector. There's only one person in the entire planet using a slide projector anymore, and he's in the room, Dave Yo. But of course, he's older than I am. And you can't laugh at Dave, because consistently, semester after semester after semester, he gets the highest ratings of anybody in our department. He is fantastic. And he's the epitome of what good teaching is about, slide projector or not. But if we wanted music, had to get out their record player, and they used to wheel those TV carts across campus. I can't tell you how many of those went flying off the carts and shattered on the pavement. But the way classes are taught in college, 95% of them are lecture. And that's how they were run. And most of the faculty who are in the room are here because they were really good at doing lectures, sitting in lectures, taking notes, giving the information back. And today, we still try to teach our classes that way. But if you didn't do that, you just sort of fell away from the educational machine and went into other business. So I got ready for my classes. Getting ready for the first day, I prepped for my classes. And I prepared some brilliant lectures. I mean, everything that I had pent up from 10 years of teaching public school, those poor souls in my first class, they got it on the very first day. And about midway through, it wasn't working so well. I wasn't speaking their language. They were far less interested in what I had to say to them than what I had for them to do when we actually got into a situation where we were moving. And I took lessons from adventure running then. I had that class at 8 o'clock in the morning, and those kids came in just completely bleary-eyed. Dan, did you ever have that class with me? No? Yeah. And we went out and we got into the woods, and they had to solve problems about where they were going, how they were gonna get there, and if they were gonna get back. And it was just fantastic to see their engagement. So I paid attention to that. Clyde Washburn, who's one of my favorite philosophers. I know Bill Newell's a favorite philosopher of people on campus, but Clyde Washburn is actually my favorite philosopher. He used to say, saying ain't doing, and knowing ain't teaching. And just because we know stuff about our subject matter, which we all do, hell, if you go to college for 28 years the way we all do, if you don't know it by the time you get out, there's something wrong. The problem is, can you communicate that to your students? So just because you know something about your subject doesn't mean you can teach it. We have so many people who say, oh, you're a college teacher, man, I could do that, you know what I'm saying? I could do that. And you haven't got a clue what to do. Because they don't teach you how to teach in college and graduate school, they teach you how to do research. And you get taught by people who haven't any idea about how to teach either. They just lecture at you. So we come in here and we lecture at our students. That's the way it's supposed to be, right? And we all have plenty to say. It's not supposed to be humorous. I told you I don't like politics, but this is humorous. Anyway, the trick is knowing how to say it and what to do with it and knowing when no one is listening. She hasn't figured that out. So Bob Dylan also emerged in the 1960s, and Bob Dylan One of his song lyrics was, "Come gather around, people, wherever you roam, and admit that the waters around you have grown, and accept it that soon you'll be drenched to the bone. If your time to you is worth saving, then you better start swimming or you'll sink like a stone, for the times they are a-changing." And my students were changing. I got a million of them. But I knew I had to do something different. I couldn't keep lecturing. I had to do something else. So first, if you're going to start swimming and you're going to make some changes, you better figure out who your students are. So these are our students. And to them, the central portion of their life right now is their cell phone. It's not their family. It's not their friends. They can connect to those people through their cell phone, but it is their cell phone. And Sherry Turkle just wrote a book called Alone Together. And these are just the students. So you all in your classes have students using their cell phones. When they go out of the room to the bathroom, you know they're getting their cell phones out. Current fashion for the boys is these sweatpants with big pockets that and their cell phones out before they even get out of the room. So the cell phone's it, and you have to understand that. They're also video learners. They love video. That's how they learn best, how they communicate best, it's how they deal with things best. I used to go to the movies with Adam to see various things that Sherry wouldn't want to see. We used to see the Terminator movies, and we'd see all these movies with people's heads getting blown up. And Adam would sit next to me in the movie and say, "Dad, you see that? You see that?" And I said, "What?" And he said, "Sit." Well, we'd get the movie on DVD, we'd rewind it, and in slow motion, everything that he described to me in the scene happened, but I could only see it in slow motion. He saw it at full speed. His whole generation sees it at full speed. We don't. We are short attention span theater. So this is the news. Here's a picture of the president. Looks like something's happening in another country, and that's all for today. Tune in again tomorrow. Our students don't have large attention spans the way we would like them to have. They also speak and write in their own code. That means too long, didn't read. Our students don't like to read. They write in code, that's how they communicate. So how we have handled that is we have decided to engage in a mutual non-aggression pact with our students. And this is not only Eastern, and I think Eastern less so than other places, but at big universities, this is the case. We just say to our students, okay, you don't bother me, I won't bother you. I'll just get in front of the room and lecture, blah, 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 blah. You'll take notes. Here's the study guide. Actually, here's the test bank. Actually, here's the answers in the text bank. And you'll give me good reviews.
Sorry?
You give me good reviews, and I'll teach it by autopilot, and then I'll go out and do research, and I'll get promoted. So our students say, hell, that's a good deal. Okay. And so we lecture. My sports analogy for this is lecturing is like a professional soccer game where the official, the referee, holds the ball the entire time. And as a teacher, we're the referee, we have the ball in our hands the whole time, and these really talented people out in front of us, our students, sit there and they're waiting for us to throw them the ball or at least give them a chance to play. And we don't give them a chance to play instead, we just talk to them. And this is really interesting because I'm telling you about it, you know? And I'm interested in it, so are you, you know? So it's not a good thing. Discussion in classes often takes the form of the teacher asks a question, the best student in class answers it in two words, and then the teacher spends 10 minutes explaining the answer to the class instead of asking the student to explain it or having other students answer questions. So it's like youth soccer to me, where two or three stars control the thing the whole time and the rest of the students just zone out. Then came PowerPoint. And this is the usual reaction to PowerPoint. Horror followed quickly by stupor. And our students hate PowerPoint. A couple of students are here from one of my courses, and early in the semester I said, what makes a bad class? What makes a bad college class? We're doing assessment evaluation, talking about rubrics and how to decide what's good, what's bad. So I brought it to them, and they said, the worst possible thing a teacher can do is PowerPoint, the worst. I don't consider this PowerPoint today, but it's on the verge. So, but the PowerPoint where the teacher has the slide up and reads the slide to you. It's got so much text on it, you can't possibly decipher it quickly enough, and you can't take notes on it, and we know that. So we'll give you the notes, and then you can take the notes home. So why'd you come to class? Why'd you have a class if you're going to do it that way? We need to give up the standard PowerPoint, I think, the one that I just complained about. We force our students to remember things for multiple choice exams, stuff they'll forget really quickly, and they're bored. It's a disservice to them. This is one of my favorite education quotes. I discovered this quote 10 or 15 years ago. I cannot find this guy anywhere. I cannot find the source anywhere. I just have this quote. And we do try to develop the memory at the expense of the imagination. So we need to somehow make our stuff interesting. What's interesting to me, I have to make it interesting to them. Even if it's their major, I have to make it interesting to them. So exactly how do you do that? I think you have to reflect on what you do and why you do it, and then how your students react to it. You have to look at the people in the room, the people who are you're talking to, the people you want to connect with. If you just stand behind your desk, I don't want to say this happens a lot, but it does. And I walk by classrooms and I see a teacher, I don't have a lectern to lean on, I see a teacher like this, talking, and I look at the students, because I look at students and not the teacher, and the students are just slumped down. And that's not what we want. We want something better. If what we're doing is not working, why do you think that doing more of it is going to improve the situation? So you need to think about changing how you teach. Change is threatening. I put the screaming baby in there because I had a flashback when I saw this too, changing my son's diaper when he was a year old. And I couldn't get the safety pin through the diaper, and he's screaming, usually very passive at this. And of course I was putting the pin into his thigh. Anyway, change is threatening. He didn't like it anymore when he saw me coming. No, couldn't talk, but I didn't want you. Change is threatening at first. So you have to decide what your goal is when you're teaching. What do you want to teach? What do you want your class to get from you? And teach to that rather than the memorization of those note cards, which is when I have students who need to know stuff, I have to talk to them about using note cards. But what more do I want them to get from me? How do I make it more interesting besides giving them more information? You know how when you give them so much information and they're bored, so you just give them more information? It doesn't do a good job. So what does interest your students? Who are these people? There's Miley Cyrus on the left and, oh, Caitlin, that's good. Bruno Mars on the right. And if you just have a picture of Bruno Mars and just talk about the physiology of his head, you'd get students more interested than if you just put a diagram of a cranium up there. He's interesting. That guy can move. He's fabulous. She's unusual. And we talk about cultural literacy all the time. So there was a book 10, 15 years ago, Hirsch, Cultural Literacy, and there was a big complaint about our students didn't know anything about their past. And hell, why should they? I asked my students a couple of weeks ago, I asked them if they've ever heard of Bing Crosby. Now, half of you are going, who? Bing Crosby, in 1944, 45, 46, was a top-selling record artist, a top-selling movie attraction, and the top-grossing radio program. He was number one in all three of those categories. No one's ever done that since. And they had no idea who he was. And I won't sing you a Bing Crosby song. But it's a two-way street. Cultural literacy is a two-way street. And the more you understand their cultural literacy, the more you can connect with them. And some people in my department are really good at that. They pay attention to what the students are doing, thinking, and asking about. So these are some of the things we have. I got this from Maggie Sayers, who told me this is big stuff. But these are UGG boots. You see women wearing these things with shorts and that kind of fur trim. I don't get that, but they do. And my son Adam told me about listicles. I apparently just published a listicle. Hold your applause. PlayStation, Netflix. Adam told me about Marcel Lachelle. Do you know Marcel Lachelle? You gotta look at Marcel Lachelle on YouTube. He is so cool. I haven't seen him enough to do a good imitation of Marcel Lachelle. And of course, right in the center, emojis, and right in the center, the cell phone. The cell phone is it. It's the center of the universe, not the sun, the cell phone. So somehow you're going to have to hook your students, somehow. Their phones, their culture, their music, TED Talks, a poem, a song, a story, something to get your students in, to bring them in touch with you. Students learn by immersion. We only had a few pictures ever taken of adventure running. Nick Lacey came out in my last spring to do it. He came out the spring before, but he got lost. My students didn't, but he did. And he came out this year, and part of one of our runs is out on the Natchog River in Chaplin at Nicholson's campground, and we crossed the Natchog River there. We put a rope out for safety. That's Mr. Geithner right in the middle of the water. He was helping me out the last couple of years. And our students figured out about learning how to cross a river by actually crossing a river. So instead of having one soccer ball and 22 people standing around, give everybody a soccer ball somehow. Several people in here are former students who are now teaching in the public schools. It's nice to see them. And they know this. You have to give kids a lot of equipment so that they can all learn at the same time. You can't teach math skills with one pencil. You can't teach computer skills with one computer. And you can't teach in education without everybody sharing the information. So Dan said to me that I make my students write, and I do. And several of them are here with the battle wounds and the scars from it. But I have always tried to hold my students to the highest standard of written English, so that when they go out in the public schools, they themselves will never write a memo with an error in it. And I want them. I can't teach them how to do that, but I can make them aware of how important it is to not do that. Make them write, then you grade it. You correct it, I'm sorry, that's a wrong statement. You correct it, then you turn it back to them. Then they correct it and turn it back to you. Then you correct it again and turn it back to them. And that's how writing works. They don't do well if you just say, oh, that looks like a B+ to me. I never was able to grade like that. Make them write. Give them group work. Think about that and think about how to do group work and actually read books about it and come up with ideas. For me, group work is like soccer 3-on-3 with a game here and a game there and a game there and a game there. And you got six kids fighting over a soccer ball. Everybody learns to play soccer all at the same time without you doing anything except organizing it, making it happen. They bond through shared activities. These are physical activities, but you can have other kinds of activities, projects, presentations, community service, shared quizzes. I used to give students the chance to take quizzes together in my classroom. So what if they all got 100? At least they reviewed the material. And if they didn't do it ahead of time, they did it right during that quiz, so I didn't have to review it. Stories about you are always interesting. I find myself fascinating. And because of that, my students do too. No, but stories about you are really cool. So if I'm talking, my poor son he doesn't know it because he's been not in class with me, but anytime I talk about readiness, I talk about Adam because we talk about when he was ready to be toilet trained, when he was ready to speak. Oh, come on, Pat, get over it. And those things, when you have a real life, when you're a real person in front of your students, they connect with it and they connect with the material. So. It's stories about you are great. It's the only time, actually, you have their undivided attention. When you say, and they go like this, they're right with you. Physical educators have something called instant activities. And we do this to change the pace in a class. We do this to change the focus of a class. Because if you don't change focus in a class, how long can you go with one modality in teaching? I'm going way too long with this right here. I would have broken the class up and had you in groups already by now, but that's not going to work. So instant activities for phys ed, there's instant activities for classroom. They're really good. You can set something up in 5 minutes, get your students all buzzing about what it is you're talking about in class. You need this repertoire. When you ask questions in class, usually it's that one star who answers every time. Ooh. Mr. Cotta. I got it. But the other students just sit there. If you have your students write answers to questions on index cards and then swap them with each other and then have them read those answers out loud if they think those answers are good, everybody at least had a chance to process and commit to paper what they thought the answer to that question was. I always felt I had to have some rules in class. My rules are up to 52 now, but I like them. The students don't, but when students yawn in class, it really upsets me. And when they use their cell phone in class, when they give me excuses. So I don't let them wear hats in class either. I'm glad to see nobody's wearing a hat in here today. I appreciate that. But rules are good because kids do well with rules. Students do well with rules. They don't do well if you leave it up to them to sort it out. They need guidelines. I also tried to set high standards for writing in my class, and I want my students to do better than they think they can. I want more from them than they think they're able to give, and a lot of times I get a lot of negative feedback from that, but I've never backed down from that, and I don't think anybody should back down in the classroom from the standards, mutual non-aggression pact or otherwise. So the F word is actually fun, and fun has a big place in education to me. The more they enjoy it, the more they will learn from the situation. Everybody's laughing in this picture, and there I am in the center, gesticulating. Is that the French thing? I have just made a humorous connection between crossing the river in springtime and sex. And this, I won't do it now, but the students just enjoyed the moment. And then I was able to talk to them about what we had just done. I got their attention. A long time ago in a galaxy far, far away, we went into this field because we really thought we wanted to be teachers. Not because we had studied some subject and could get a job at a college and do research, because we wanted to teach. And you have a passion for it, and you need to convey that to your students. It's almost like conducting a symphony, which is what everybody in these photographs is doing. Everybody's involved, and these people are leading the way, just figuratively and literally. So when you first got that job, just remember how you felt the first time you got that job, even if it was just as a rabbit in a top hat. It was a job, and you embrace it, so do it. Our students, this is the new learning modality, our students are mesmerized by video, and they're visual electronic learners, even if they can't read the words. That's who they are. Who's number one? Not you. Students. You have to meet the students' needs. Your course evaluations, some of them come back really nasty. Whoa. And so a test of your character is what you do with that. You see something like that and you say, I could do better than that, I should do better than that, I need to do better than that. Learn from those things and grow from the criticism. Just don't brush them aside as that idiot kid. He didn't know what he's talking about, because I am fascinating. Get a friend to observe you in class. Have somebody come in and watch you teach and then be ready to take it on the chin afterwards. But that will help you be a better teacher, because people who watch you see much more than you will. Final thoughts, less is more. Teach less material, but cover it in more detail with more approaches and more modalities and more ideas and more ways for your students to grasp the material. And they'll get much more, rather than all that stuff that they memorized for your exam, then went and got a drink at the water fountain and then forgot. Think about your teaching. Not about how you're going to get through the next class, but what you want to do to make it meaningful. Integrate the liberal arts. I have a liberal arts background. I was a history major, and I pursued that lawyer thing about as far as I could go and keep my sanity. But in the process, I learned about music and art and education and theater and all those other things, and those all play into every subject that we teach here in school, everything. So integrate that. Integrate your cultural literacy. They'll be fascinated to know who Bing Crosby is, maybe. But they're fascinated to know that you actually pay attention to who they are, what they like, and what they're interested in. And even if you can't connect with them on that level, they know you're interested in them because you're paying attention to them. So whether it's changing your teaching or singing in a school show or giving a last lecture, don't be too afraid of failure, because chances are you're going to mess up a little bit. You'll more likely regret what you didn't do than what you did. And Derek McBride, who is a retired lieutenant from the police department here, been gone 10 years or so from the department, he said at his final remarks to the university, he said, We're all in this together, whether you're a policeman, whether you're a grounds worker, Mike, whether you, wouldn't matter what you do here, we're all together trying to help our students do better. We have people in this room from every walk of the university, all trying to do better for the students. We're in it together. So, my best advice to you, go get some exercise. Preferably in the woods, not on the street, not in the gym. Go out in the woods. Go for a walk in the woods. Today would have been a fabulous day for a walk in the woods instead of on that exercise bicycle. It clears your head. It puts you in touch with nature. You hear the birds. You forget about things. Leave your cell phone home. It works wonders. What am I going to do to stay busy? Well, let me see. This is me in Cornwall about 8 years ago. It's one of the first selfies, Maggie. I took this. And this is me in Shanghai on 6 o'clock on a 90 degree morning, 120% humidity. And Adam and I were touring China together then, and he took that picture of me playing badminton in the streets with this guy who was really good. And this is me, Dan, you recognize this? This is on, and Crispin, recognize this? This is on top of the Horseshoe in England in the Lake District. And I have 3 honors students with me on that trip. We spent 3 weeks together. We don't look too good because we've been out 3 nights in a row on the hills. Again, this is China on a bicycle a couple of years ago. And this is the coastal path in Pembrokeshire, Wales, where if you think that it doesn't look dangerous, it is. There's no fences anywhere. And the path is literally 1 foot from going over the edge. Fortunately, the wind always blows in. So I was on the golf course Saturday morning, my first round of the year, and playing with my friend Ken Serino, and we get to the 12th hole. And the 12th hole is just one of these holes in the golf course, and there's a tree that used to be there, and it's gone. And Ken said to me, you remember when we used to play with Angie Coriale, and he hated that tree because he hit the ball into that tree every time? And I said, I was just thinking about him, and thinking about that tree, and thinking about Angie playing golf with us. And I said, where is he? What happened? And Angie's in his 80s. So Angie was a star football player at Springfield College. He has 4 of the 6 longest touchdown runs ever. He did that in 1949. He batted 480 one season for the baseball team. It's still a single season record for batting. And he was a school principal in East Longmeadow, the town where I now live, for many years at many different schools. And I got home, I got an email. Angie Coriale died at 9 o'clock or 9:30, whenever it was that we were talking about him, the minute we were talking about him, and he came into both our heads, he died. And I just thought, you know, I'm retiring at a good time. Time is precious. So I'm going to go out and take advantage of that. So I want to thank you for your attention today. And in case you didn't know what to, Nancy canceled a cruise apparently to be here to see Elvis in the corner of the screen. So thank you very much.
Just let me say quickly, thank you so much to Neil. That was just brilliant. Fortunately, we have recorded this, and it'll be on YouTube, and I think there's a perfect lecture to incorporate into the new faculty orientation every year. What a great way for somebody to start. But it also occurs to me that this is a terrific gift for you to give your son, who I know just accepted a teaching position at Sonoma State. And so now you have your father's best lessons about how to be a really terrific teacher. So I think it's a wonderful gift to your son, wonderful gift to all of us. Thank you very much, Neil. Please stay, enjoy some refreshments and talking to Neil, and thanks very much for coming, all of you.